Okay, well, first I want to thank Gary and my script for inviting me here today. I can't tell you what a pleasure it is to be totally surrounded by people who are thinking about next generation expressively powerful interfaces, including speech and pen and multimodal and so forth. What I'm going to talk about today is actually the last two talks were so related. I felt like I was the person talking half the time. What I'm going to do now is give it a slightly different slant and give you a little more perspective from a human-centric point of view, what it's like for a user to use a pen and what the impact of the pen and handwriting is on users. So it'll be a cognitive point of view. And I'm going to have to, there's a lot of research behind what I talk about today, but I'm going to give you a very, very brief introduction. So if I say something that interests you, please jot it down and catch me later and ask me a question, because there's probably a lot more story behind it. I'm just listing about three books here that all go into a lot more detail. And if you're really interested, you know, I invite you to take a look at these. Oops, went too far. So most of you are well aware. My main area is human-centered design, HCI. During the past 10 years, we've had a major paradigm shift from being keyboard dominant, so single input technology really dominating most of computing, to now having cell phones be more of the epicenter, including writing, touch, multi-touch, gesture, speech, and other new modalities all becoming available. And of course, the trend now is adding increasing numbers of new sensors to that. So we've not only gone to this whole variety of new, more natural and expressively powerful media, but we've gone from one input tool to a variety of input tools. And what's significant about that from a cognitive point of view is not just that they're more natural and they leverage natural human communication, but you can use any one or combination of them to better match with the functionality of a given application. So these changes reflect, from my point of view, the evolution of more expressively powerful computer input, which is directly supporting human cognition and performance. When I talk about expressively powerful, what I mean, there are lots of different ways we could define this, but I think expressively powerful interfaces are ones that can transmit multiple representations. The pen is really the premier example of this. So you can not only write words, but diagrams, numbers, symbols, and easily shift very in a facile way between those at any moment. Multiple modalities on another list here is one area that I've spent a lot of my career working on. So it's designing systems that combine pen, speech, touch. It's basically the cell phone is now the epicenter. So how do we, you know, create an environment where a user can at any moment speak and then interject, say, writing or drawing on a map, and just go back and forth between modalities as needed. The third area is multiple linguistic codes. So I became interested in this because, of course, the keyboard was designed by and for English speakers. Keyboards are better at transmitting Roman alphabetic languages than the other 80% of world languages that are not Roman alphabetic. And since language is a direct carrier of thought, interfaces that make it possible to fluently and unambiguously transmit your native language support reduction of your cognitive load and your ability to think and reason more accurately. In contrast, it's very clear from our research that existing keyboard interfaces constrict communication, and they are undermining cognition performance. there's a lot of data showing that people are not aware of this, so there's not a conscious awareness of it. Pretty much every study we do shows that. People think they're doing just fine with a keyboard, and there's not a very good ability to introspect about that. Just quick nutshell, what do I mean, limitations of the keyboard? Well, you know, from a communications perspective, this is communications interface design we're talking about here. Keyboards are better at supporting unimodal textual input. They're not transmitting the rich multiple modalities that we talked about on the last slide. From the point of view of representational content, they're better at transmitting linguistic and numeric content, not so good at the spatially intensive content that's involved in diagrams or symbologies. They're also better, as I said earlier, at transmitting Roman alphabetic languages that have a small number of elements and that are not so spatially intensive as many other world languages. So in summary, what is the keyboard best at? Well, it is good at some things, but it was never designed as a thinking tool. Okay, so it's really better for what I would describe as relatively mechanical tasks, whether it's email, text editing, web search, it's fine at all those things. And you know, maybe not surprisingly, that's the majority of the functionality that we now all experience when we use computing. So we might ask, is the keyboard playing a role in holding back the functionality of computing? I want to say just a couple words, and I won't be able to go into any detail here, but why am I talking so much about computer input tools? Why is computer input so important? Tool use from a cognitive archaeology point of view is always been viewed as the hallmark of human cognitive evolution. What I'm showing on the upper right-hand side here is just a very quick schematic diagram of, there are basically two phases during evolution that cognitive archaeologists focus on, where the design of physical stone tools changed qualitatively in important ways and were associated with spurts in brain-to-body ratio. Now, of course, like physical tools, digital tools are tools. They're just extension of our array of available tools. I like to give the following example, and we can argue about exact dates, but if you look at the emergence of alphabetic languages, roughly 6,000 years ago, people started using a stylus to write, and as they created content, they learned to read what they had written. And cognitive psychologists, neuropsychologists, from their point of view, have analyzed the fact that what was initially a visual cortex for distinguishing objects in the world, you know, an apple from an orange, basically developed what's now considered the visual word form area for letter recognition. So as we use tools to create new alphabetic languages, we also developed brain areas to distinguish fine-grained letter patterns. So what's the impact? Well, the impact of starting to use pens was literally the evolution of the read-write cycle supporting all of modern literacy. So pens have done a few things for civilization. There is a huge body of research, and I really don't have time to go into all the really fascinating, extensive studies that have been done in cognitive neuroscience, but there's clear evidence showing that actively writing letters, manually creating the complex shapes of letters, activates your visual word form area, and it improves your ability to recognize those letters and to comprehend their meaning and context, so when you're reading running text. And it does so more, actually writing, manually doing the effort of constructing those letters, stimulates that area and your related letter recognition comprehension more than typing, passively viewing the letter, or naming the letter, any of these other more passive things. So writing complex letter shapes creates a long-term sensory motor memory that's part of the reading neural circuit. And it is effectively a multimodal circuit. So when you write, it's not just a manual experience. There are some auditory and haptic and other multisensory components of that that reinforce your learning. In designing digital tools, one of the things we started doing, it must have been at least a decade ago, is we started asking what we thought was a really naive question. But somehow I thought to myself, I don't think anyone else in computer science is really asking this question, so I'm curious. And that is, can a computer input tool per se influence human cognition? That is, if I take you and I give you, you know, the same person, the same set of tasks, and I give you a keyboard, and then I take it away, and I give you a digital pen, and I take it away, and I give you a different input tool, will that affect your ability to do any of the things I've listed here, to just solve a math problem correctly, to engage in accurate inferential reasoning where you're not overgeneralizing, which is what humans do rampantly, or to fluently produce domain-appropriate ideas? Let's say it's science, and I ask you to generate a lot of hypotheses to explain a data set. You know, same person, same task, I'm just gonna give you a different computer input tool. And so I didn't think the answer would be yes. I thought, no, you know, there'll probably be some other interesting things we'll find in this research, but I don't think it's really gonna affect whether you can just solve the problem more correctly or not. So in one study, and again, I apologize, there are a number of studies on this topic. I'm only gonna have time today to give one example, to give you the flavor. We investigated the impact of using pen interfaces, including digital paper and pen, and pen on tablets, with other alternatives like using a keyboard. So it was keyboard-centric, it did have a supplementary pen, or using a non-digital pen. So just a regular old pen, non-digital pen. So in this particular study, you know, the question we asked was, can computer input tools that support multiple representations? So they're expressively powerful in that dimension. And the premier example is the pen. Can it facilitate the fluency of producing ideas? And the domain was science hypotheses. Can kids generate more science hypotheses appropriately? The students were high school students who were millennials. They'd all grown up using keyboards, okay? So they were less familiar with digital pens. We had to familiarize them. And it was within subject study, so we'd give them non-digital paper and pen, digital paper and pen, a Noto style, pen tablets, and a keyboard-centric tablet. And we just looked at, does the tool we give them per se change the amount they communicate and what they communicate? Because remember, my view is language is a direct carrier of thought. If I can support your language, I'm supporting your thought. And then we looked at directly at cognition. So was their fluency of producing domain-appropriate ideas changing too? So we looked at both of those. Here's the kind of, the students had a lot of fun with this. We'd show them, for example, on the left side a data set. This one was changes in the homicide rate in England between 1200 and 2000. And we'd say list as many hypotheses as you can for why the data shifted as it did over the years. Or on the right-hand side, we'd show them two physical structures, a human foot and a chimp foot. And we'd say list as many hypotheses as you can for how the function of a human versus chimp foot could have led to these differences in structural appearance. So this is the kind of stuff they were working on. First we found, and on the left-hand side, I want you to look on the left-hand side figure first, that's mean non-linguistic fluency. So how many diagrams, symbols, and numbers were they producing? So if I gave you the digital pen, you produced 44% more non-linguistic content. I take away the pen, now I give you the keyboard. What do you know? I give you the keyboard, we're now looking at the right-hand side, for the same problem, same person produces 36% more linguistic content, so more words, fewer diagrams, fewer numbers, fewer symbols. And what happened when we did that is the pen interfaces, and this is both digital paper and pen and the pen tablet, that had just stimulated you to write more non-linguistic content, also facilitated your hypothesis generation. So now we're looking at the left-hand side, and this is average ideational fluency. So the number of domain-appropriate ideas you produced as you use that implement. So the pen interfaces increase students' appropriate hypothesis generation 38%. So you can do the math on that. It's about 4 grade points. This is not a small change. And then what we found was if we knew an individual student's average non-linguistic fluency, we could predict the variation in their ability to generate related hypotheses. So here what I'm showing is just basically a linear trend where if your non-linguistic fluency was high, I could predict most of the range within which you would be producing hypotheses. If it was medium or low, likewise. So we were accounting for 72% of all the variance in kids' ability to produce domain-appropriate ideas just by knowing how much non-linguistic fluency. So again, diagramming, numbers, and symbols. This was the critical content that they were expressing with the pens. What happened with the keyboard? The keyboard, remember, they produced more linguistic fluency? Well, there's something else they were doing. When they used the keyboard, they gave us more words, and they also were very almost like functionally fixed on expressing it as full sentential constructions. So they were more focused on being kind of formal and expressive in the way they delivered their words. This combination was inversely related to producing ideas. In other words, it distracted them from thinking about the problem of producing domain-appropriate hypotheses. Instead, they were focused on the language and constructing the language in a formal manner. So we were accounting for 62% of the drop in their ability to produce ideas, sadly. So let me summarize this part. First, digital tools can stimulate more communication than non-digital ones. So I didn't focus on that a lot. There are whole studies on this. So if I give you a digital pen, I take it away, and then I give you a non-digital pen. Is there a difference in what you do? Yes, there is. You communicate more with a digital pen. And remember, if I stimulate your communicative fluency, I am also stimulating your ability to think and reason. So I want you communicating more. So, you know, giving someone a digital pen is a great idea in classrooms, even compared with a non-digital pen. The expressively powerful interfaces, and now I'm talking across our studies, like the pen, can facilitate cognition substantially. So in our studies, we've seen between about 10 and almost 40%. Other people have done studies showing 60% improvements. We find that the pen's ability to support non-linguistic and especially spatial content, diagramming, spatializing your thinking, was what was mediating the improvements in cognition. So don't think that handwriting recognition, you know, the pen is all about just recognizing your words. That's not necessarily what we want it to do. That's fine, but it's only part. And our findings have generalized across different contents. So today I'm talking about science. We've done studies on math, language arts. We've done studies on different types of cognition and also users of different ability levels and ages. Now I want to ask the question, well, how can we magnify this effect in the future? It's a pretty cool trick. Can we design digital pens with greater impact on facilitating cognition than what I'm showing here today, which is only English speakers, okay? Let's go back to our roadmap. I'm going to call this our design roadmap. We've talked about pen interfaces and optimizing expression of multiple representations. Opportunity number one that I see is definitely something where a number of us are all on the same page, and that is combining pen within a more powerful multimodal interface. Now, in the bad old past, technologists have been very competitive. They said, well, what's going to win, the pen or speech or touch? No, that's not what it's about. We don't want to play that game. We want to play the game of merge and conquer, not divide and conquer. Okay, so we really will benefit from multimodal. Second opportunity, develop pen-centric multimodal interfaces and focus on those non-Roman languages, because the keyboard is a much bigger impediment. And I know I'm speaking to the choir because there are probably a lot of people here whose native language is not a Roman alphabetic one. So when I say integrate the pen within a multimodal interface, some of the things that I see as an advantage are, one, we've talked about the fact that it will move us forward in improving or maximizing expressive power. So one quick example, I'm sitting in my car. What do I use speech for? Well, for things in the future, in the past, things that are out of view. I may say to the map system, show me Santa Clara. It auto-locates, centers the map on Santa Clara, okay? And I can't do that with my hand, I don't know where it is. Okay, I need to use speech for that. Then I may use the pen, and I'm looking for real estate today. Okay, I'm down here, investor, and I'm circling certain streets. Okay, so I'm really picky. I know where the streets are that I wanna find a house on, and sooner or later, I'm gonna find it. So I encircle those irregular shapes, and then I say, show me homes for sale. Or I may use the pen further and just write 2BR. So pens, what do? We abbreviate a lot. It's not all about words. It's a heck of a lot of abbreviation. I may write 2BA. I want a 2-bedroom, 2-bath condo. I may write symbol less than 1 million or something like that. The other big opportunity with designing pen-centric multimodal interfaces is that you can develop fusion-based systems with better recognition rates, and you need that for your mobile applications, okay? You need it for in-vehicle big time. You need it for any mobile application. So there's been lots of research in the past showing that a multimodal, for example, we pioneered the first fusion-based speech and pen system. It performed consistently better than speech only or pen only. So you get with the architectures we had, you get what's called mutual disambiguation. So partial meaning coming from one modality would constrain the interpretation of the other modality, and you would end up with higher recognition rates. So that's another long story. The other direction, the second opportunity I talked about, is developing pen-centric systems for non-Roman languages, 80% of the world. I won't go into a lot of detail here, but it's pretty clear that keyboards fail to support spatially intensive scripts, a lot of scripts with diacritics, for example, and a lot of languages that have a large number of linguistic units, where what people are doing is typing multiple keystrokes to enter what we would consider one character, and then selecting from homophone lists. And for some languages, they're unbelievably long. So the bottom line is that the keyboard doesn't support fluent and unambiguous transmission of your native language. That translates into, that tool is holding me back. I can't express and think. I want to do those, one's a carrier for the other, and I want to do them without impedance. Again, I know for a lot of you, I'm preaching to the choir here. When I was over in India, I was watching a little boy trying to enter Hindi, directly express himself using InScript on a QWERTY keyboard for typing Hindi on a cell phone. Well, there you've got three levels of keyboard. So he had to remember, and this is a very smart little boy, okay, but he had to remember, okay, which level is the letter I need next? He'd toggle between them. If he wanted to type something like the monkey stole the peppers off the balcony, He's shifting between these. To enter the first word, he's typing the various characters. I got 1, 2, 3, 4. On key number 2, it's going to pop open. Here we go with the homophones. So what we're doing here is, you know, disambiguating. And you see the diacritics at work for a language like this. He actually had to disambiguate meaning 5 times to distinguish the vowels and ligatures in Hindi with these kind of pop-up windows in order just to get this one sentence done. So it's a big ordeal. The impact, well, keyboard is slower input, higher cognitive load, more errors. There's one Japanese study showing that users completing the same task with a pen versus a keyboard. With a keyboard, they made 14-fold more errors than the pen. So you may think you're doing just fine with a keyboard. You're not noticing, you know, the overgeneralizations in your inferencing, and you're not noticing all of the errors that you are making. So we're expecting, the studies haven't been done, they need to be done. There needs to be research looking specifically not only at the cognitive advantages of pen and multimodal over keyboard for various kinds of cognitive tasks with these kinds of languages, but also then to take that data and optimize those interfaces. So I'm not suggesting they're going to be identical to the ones that we develop for Roman alphabetic languages. So I do think we need, you know, local experts, native speakers of those languages as part of those design teams. Other major directions for pen systems? Well, you know, obviously I think there are a lot of people here interested in seeing expansion of the education market based on much higher performing tools. I'm a parent too. I would not let my kid use a keyboard for a lot of the things they're doing right now in schools. I've sat in the back of a Singapore classroom, so-called model classroom, where students were required to do everything they were learning on a keyboard. And I watch kids with a little piece of paper next to the keyboard, and they were trying to do math and they're writing stuff out because that's what they were thinking on, okay? And that was a no-no, you know? And then they would type in their answer. I thought, okay, so yeah, they're thinking with a pen and then they're pleasing the teacher. And that was really sad. I thought, okay, this is a model classroom. No, it is not. Okay. The other big opportunity, another whole direction, is ink analytics. It's really barely begun. We're doing some work on this. So if you want to sell better performing educational technologies to schools, these days, one of the things they're going to ask you is, are you taking away my keyboard? I'm used to clickstream analytics. Do you have any ink analytics? Usually the answer is no. But there are people starting to do work on this. And I heard, Patty's discussion of the Chinese classroom, where they're already asking him, do you have tools that we can use to start analyzing students' answers so we can grade them automatically and not waste our time on that? I think my gloss of what I understood from Patty's talk was they were asking for things that would recognize the content of what students wrote, which is great. But there are also opportunities that we're discovering that involve signal level and activity level patterns during handwriting that are surprisingly predictive of your domain expertise in areas like math. So I think we should be looking at different levels of analyzing ink, pulling together the most predictive features. Some of them will be surprising, okay, and put them together into ink analytics that have the highest performing results. The other opportunity that I see, and I haven't heard much about it yet today, but it's a favorite of mine, and that is, I personally think we need more bold, out-of-the-box designs. It's what I call digitally functional art. I think we need to think about the aesthetics and the emotional appeal, and not just think of digital pen technology and inking as something for transmitting information. It should be something we become attached to, that we're proud of, that we display. For me as a female, I like the idea of, you know, jewelry or nails with basically a point where when I'm manipulating these ridiculously minuscule icons on my Apple phone, I can pick them, and I don't have to enter one letter at a time in a clumsy way with my finger. I want to use something precise. So I think that wearable and embedded writing tools, that there ought to be a lot more brainstorming about that, just interactive inking concepts with powerful new functionality is another direction, and one that I know a lot of people are very interested in here today. So some quick conclusions. Again, I apologize, this went by fast, but computer interfaces can powerfully influence, either by enhancing or undermining, your ability to think and learn. I think you will be surprised, and when we start looking at impact on children who are not just English speakers, the effects are going to be even larger. And my view is that learning, we all engage, or we better engage in lifelong learning, right? So this is not just about kids in schools. It's about we need to be picking up new things all the time in our jobs and everyday lives. So digital pen and multimodal input that incorporate it are ideally suited for stimulating cognition. I do think there's a critical need for well-developed pen-centric ecosystems to revolutionize education. There is an amazing opportunity there if we can develop the ecosystems and link them within multimodal, you know, flexible, really supportive multimodal interfaces. And especially ones where we've investigated all of these issues, which hasn't been done yet, for many world languages, some of the largest world languages, understand what the opportunities are and design for it now. So this is another, rather than reading books, if you like something short, there's a short paper that I wrote for Microsoft Partners in Learning a few years ago. It's only, you know, 5-6 pages. It gives a quick summary of some of the cognitive impact things and also a bunch of other references if you want to read other work, not just me, but a lot of other work on this topic. And last quick comment, I am moving back to university in a few months. I'll be hiring new faculty and postdocs and starting new projects. So if you're interested in any of the points I made today or you have ideas for collaborating, find me. I will be here today and tomorrow. And thank you so much.
Sharon, thank you so much. Thank you. So there's a profound impact to cognitive ability depending on the device that you're using for input. This is great. Thank you, Sharon. We're going to take about a 15-minute break. Don't stray far. Get some coffee. Use the facilities. See you back here in 15 minutes.